Bonjour et bienvenue dans
Welcome to the interview
on
France
24.
We're in Rome today, and our guest is Luigi Di Maio, Italy's Foreign Affairs Minister. Welcome, Minister. Thank you for being with us.
Good afternoon.
How do you feel about the EU response to the coronavirus crisis?
The EU's response and the scope of this response is something we're going to be assessing these weeks, these days. It has to be very significant. We have high expectations. We hope the EU will prove to be on par with the challenge it has to live up to.
The next European Council meeting is coming up. What will be Italy's position?
Italy is not asking for anybody to pay its own debt. That is not our goal. We are asking other member states to set up with us the appropriate market conditions that will allow each and every member state to spend what it takes to help its businesses, its workers, its unemployed, the older citizens, etc. In order to do that, we need instruments, we need tools. We're going in the right direction. We have to make sure that on April 20th, third, we can really set the EU on a new course.
The EU is divided over the possibility of pooling the debt of member states through corona bonds. Please explain what those are and why Italy is requesting their creation.
Well, let's say there are differences in views regarding how we have to solve and address the health and economic crisis, but everybody agrees that this is an unprecedented crisis. What we're asking for today is that we define instruments that don't necessarily have to be called corona bonds or euro bonds, but that will allow us to set up the market conditions that will allow all member states to spend what it takes to help their fellow citizens. We're not asking any other country to pay for our debt. We've always lived up to our commitments. In 2019, we had targeted a deficit at 2.2%. We clocked in at 1.6%. But what's really important today is that we have to be clear. We can't address a novel situation with old instruments.
Is Italy prepared to leave the EU if your request is denied?
In current circumstances, it has to be very clear that France and Italy see eye to eye. If one country falls, all countries will fall. There can be no European Union without France, without Italy. I'm not going to bet, nor is my government, on any country leaving the EU. We're part of the European family. We were a founding member, and we believe in its founding principles. And one of those is solidarity. Solidarity has to be the name of the game. What we will be doing until the very last second of the negotiations that are underway is fight for the best possible results for Europeans and for the Italians.
But the EU has already approved unprecedented measures, such as suspending rules for budgetary discipline. There is talk of creating a 500 billion euro rescue package for Italy. Why are these measures not enough?
I think that those steps were very good. But today, I think everybody agrees, we need a lot more. We have to live up to the challenge of programming economic interventions for the next 10 years. And this is not something that has to give rise to political strife. This is something that regards the future of our grandchildren. What's been decided so far regarding the Stability Pact is fine. It's great. But we need to develop the market conditions that will allow countries to spend.
You recently broached the notion of tax havens in Europe. You spoke of double standards with specific reference to the Netherlands. Why is that?
When you talk about solidarity, when you talk about single market, you also have to understand that at the center we have to have fair competition. Tax rules have to do with the competition between our companies. They don't concern one country and not the others. You have to reason for the whole union. We've set up a single market, and we have to make sure that countries don't start acting as the reps for the big corporations of their countries. We want everybody to participate in the economic development of the EU.
You're part of the Five Stars movement, a movement that is hard to place, which sits on the fence between the left and the right-hand side of the political spectrum. A number of five-star members or representatives have welcomed the medical aid sent to Italy by China and Russia. Meanwhile, they have criticized the EU's lack of solidarity. Aren't you concerned that these ideas could surge a could cause a surge in
what I can say is that I really thank, on behalf of my government, the French authorities and the French people for the solidarity they showed us in very concrete terms, just as I thank Germany that hosted a number of our sick in its hospitals. I wish to thank so many other European countries. I wish to thank the US, China, Russia, and the 30 other countries that helped us with doctors, nurses, and equipment. We've been helped by countries all over the world. And quite clearly, this is not something that has to give rise to polarization in political terms. I want to thank everybody because without this foreign help, we would never have made it.
Could the crisis be an opportunity to ramp up cooperation between states? What was the content of your discussion with the UN Secretary General?
Yes, I spoke to Antonio Guterres, the SG of the UN, and I shared with him a proposal that we have setting up a huge international alliance for the coronavirus vaccine. We all know that if we want life to regain normalcy, we need a vaccine. And we have to be united behind that goal, not divided. The vaccine has to be a vaccine for everybody, not for the few. We have to accelerate its discovery and its distribution. This is something that is of utmost importance, and we need to do this under the aegis of the UN, and Guterres is perfectly in agreement with us.
The IMF is forecasting a major economic crisis as a result of the pandemic. Aren't you concerned the mafia might take this opportunity to spread through the country?
Grazie.
Well, thanks to a number of magistrates who fell to the mafia, we have among the very most stringent anti-mafia legislation in the world. It's become even more stringent in recent years. And we have very stringent anti-corruption rules. We have the rules we need. We have the instruments we need. But at a time such as now, the response of states and of the EU at the economic level is essential if you want to keep businesses and workers from falling prey to the mafia. That's why April 23rd is so important for the future of our fellow citizens.
In the event of an economic collapse, will the population have enough to eat?
The work that we're currently doing aims at really putting everything to work to relaunch our companies, relaunch work the economy. We hope that the estimates that have been published will be proven wrong and that we'll work fast at the European and Italian level to really re-inject the necessary resources into our economy, to relaunch investment, to re-export, and to reproduce what we've always produced that is known for its high quality.
When the crisis began, everybody already saw Italy's response to the epidemic as a model to emulate. Today, however, over 20,000 people have died and mismanagement has been reported in Italy, particularly in the Bergamo region in Lombardy, where many plants have remained in operation. This region ranks among those hardest hit, and many people have lost their lives. Are politicians responsible for this, for prioritizing the economy over people's health in Bergamo?
Now is not the time for finger pointing. Now is the time to unite to get out of this crisis. Whatever needs to be checked after the fact will be checked by our magistrates. But I can tell you that we used the very most stringent measures and we were at the forefront of the fight against the coronavirus. And I don't think any country has to be blamed, particularly in the face of this dramatic crisis. This is what we are seeing today with the U.S. and other European countries.
In February 2019, in your capacity as vice president of the previous Italian government, you met with a delegation of the Yellow Vest movement in France. In retrospect, was that meeting a mistake, do you think?
What I can say is that the Naples summit that was held a few months ago was a tremendous opportunity to relaunch cooperation between France and Italy. And with my friend and colleague Jean-Yves Le Drian, we have very good working relationship. We're working on Libya, we're working on the relations between our companies, between other sectors as well. Italy and France are stronger together now than they were before. And I like to think back to that summit because it was really the last time that Italy had the opportunity to participate in a big international event before this terrible crisis.
What will your government strategy be with regards to ending the lockdown?
With the help of an expert task force, we intend to work on reopening the country. But let's be very clear. Our goal in terms of going back to normal is a vaccine. And our second line is that of reopening the country. But we're not going to let everybody go out and wander around. We want to reopen those economic segments of the country that can do so under proper conditions because we want to preserve health.
Thank you, Minister, for being with us. Thank you to our viewers. Enjoy the rest of our programs.
Je regarde France 24 parce que en tant qu'étudiante en sciences politiques, ça me permet de rester à jour sur les informations dans le monde, sur les conflits, les débats politiques, tout ça.
الاختلاف بين فرنسا 24 والقنوات الثانيه في المحتوى المتنوع وفي التوجه الاقصى الاقرب للحياديه.
I like their coverage especially with the news and the politics. But also I like their cultural aspect because that me as a Kenyan I get to learn a lot about francophone Africa francophone in general whether it's in Europe or here just from France 24.
France 24 m'aide à voir une perspective plus complète du monde et à comprendre différentes langues, différentes cultures.
France 24, with you everywhere, all the time. Liberté, égalité, actualité.